Looks like we have a very nice crowd on. We've had very good response to this event, so I think we'll go ahead and get started with the program.
Great. Thank you, Liz. And thank you, everybody, for joining. Looking through the attendee list, I see a number of familiar names, but also quite a number of new names as well. So thanks for attending, and thanks for joining us today. The agenda that we're going to talk about today is a very brief two-slide introduction of CDDAPCO and our tool that we'll be talking about today, STAR-CCM+. Then we're going to essentially work through a conjugate heat transfer turbomachinery simulation by talking about what all goes into that, the steps involved, such as geometry handling, mesh generation, physics, and then we'll talk about some validation. Michael will perform a demonstration for us, and we'll look into some questions as well. Now, since the attendee list had quite a number of new names, I thought that today we would focus mostly on the geometry handling, mesh generation, and a high-level discussion of the physics. And then due to the interest, I thought, why don't we expand this, and later on we can continue that discussion to go maybe more deeply into the physics involved with various discussions on maybe conjugate heat transfer with solids, maybe with film cooling, things of that nature. So be on the lookout in the future for further emails from us. CDDAPCO is the world's largest independent CFD-focused provider of engineering simulation software, support, and services. And the fact that we're independent is really rather important to us, and we'll talk about why that is in a couple minutes. We have over 30 years of experience delivering our simulation solutions worldwide to a broad spectrum of application areas. And we have about 700 employees, 250 of which, or about there, are devoted to development of the tool. And this is where we come back to that independence factor. The fact that we can reinvest so heavily in the development of the tool is rather unique. Also, we have a dedicated support engineer model, meaning that we have support engineers in each of our local markets. And if you run into questions or issues that you'd like to discuss with one of our support engineers, you call that person directly. And that also is rather unique. The fact that we're independent really is what allows us to do that. STAR-CCM+ is our flagship simulation software tool. That's what we'll be discussing today. It's an integrated multi-physics simulation environment, allowing you to perform analysis on all sorts of different geometries with different physics involved. And it also represents a unified workflow. This is the tool. This little screenshot here is the one tool that you'll interact with through the entire process, all the way from CAD through meshing, post-processing, all the way through the process. So when we're talking about CHT, when we're talking about thermal analysis for turbomachinery, accurately capturing the geometry with a high-quality mesh is the very first step, and it is one of the most important steps. There's a number of capabilities that we developed. When we looked at this market and saw some of the challenges that were faced by this industry, there are a number of tools that we developed in order to overcome those challenges. And we'll talk about each one of them independently. But the overall goal is to produce a high-quality grid on a complex geometry. The first is that typically the CFD engineers, the heat transfer engineers, are given a piece of CAD from a CAD team that defines the solid, and there may not be a fluid volume present. Often there's not. Also, there could be features that are not needed, but of course, you still want to keep the geometric complexity that is relevant to the simulation. We have a 3D CAD tool that allows you to import CAD directly to STAR-CCM+ in native and neutral formats, so things like STEP, Parasolid IGES, or CATIA, NX, other native formats like that. Once you have the CAD in the tool, you're able to defeature the geometry as needed. So we obviously would leave all the geometric detail relevant to the simulation, but let's say, for example, we want to remove a portion that is irrelevant to a particular simulation. So here we have a cooled blade, and let's say that we're going to remove the portion of the geometry where we connect the disk here. We can simply lasso select the portion that we'd like to defeature, right-click, and select defeature, and it automatically removes that geometry, leaving us with CAD. So still, that's a parametric surface. We can project our mesh points to that parametric surface, but we have removed that unwanted geometry. A second challenge often faced by the community is extracting out that fluid volume. So as I mentioned, we're often past the solid geometry here, and users need the ability to be able to extract out that fluid as well to perform these conjugate heat transfer type analyses. We saw that that was a tool really missing in the market, so what we have done is developed a capability to easily select essentially the surfaces that bound that fluid and extract that internal volume. So here, if I just hide the blade, then we see the volume representation of that internal fluid. So just a couple examples of the CAD capabilities within StarCCM Plus that allow us to move down to that next step of mesh generation. So we have now a possibly defeatured representation of our CAD where we have extracted our solid and fluid volumes, and the next step is to move on to that mesh generation. The process is all pipelined in StarCCM Plus so that you set global parameters in our simulation tree environment that you see here on the right. Here we set characteristic length scales, we set characteristic boundary layer thicknesses, we set minimum sizes that we would like the majority of the mesh to be able to refine down to. But of course, you're going to want local control as well, and we offer that in essentially a series of controls available. First, you can refine on a volumetric basis. You can define arbitrary volumes within which to refine your mesh. Also, on local surfaces, you can define custom sizes or on line levels as well. Part of the benefit of having this structure, this tree structure here where you're setting up your mesh is, well, one, it's faster. We see that being able to set global sizes where most of the geometry is going to be dictated by these global sizes, it allows you to very quickly set up a high quality grid. And then also, it's part of a pipeline then, where you can replace your geometry, you can modify geometry, and you don't need to reset up any of your meshing parameters. We use polyhedral cells, where there can be an arbitrary number of faces on any given cell, and there's a very good reason for that. In fact, there are a number of very good reasons. The first of which is that a polyhedral cell, a mesh generated with polyhedral cells, requires fewer cells for a given level of accuracy. So take this example on the slide given here, where we have some arbitrary geometry. We're actually looking at the pressure drop across this cooling jacket here. And the chart on the right plots that pressure drop as a function of the number of cells used to mesh the geometry. The red line is a polyhedral mesh, and the blue line is a tetrahedral mesh. The first point is that they both grid converge. They both converge to the same pressure drop as you increase the number of cells. That's good. But we see that for a grid converged solution, there's almost an order of magnitude fewer cells required for the polyhedral mesh than the tetrahedral mesh. Well, why is that? Well, polyhedral cells have a number of good attributes. And one of them is that essentially for any flow direction, for any direction that the flow is impinging on this given cell that we're looking at here, we have faces that are orthogonal or nearly orthogonal to that flow direction. This makes it very good for flows without a primary flow direction or swirling flows like tip vortices with turbomachinery. So we see here that obviously with the polyhedral cell, no matter the flow direction, we have faces that are orthogonal, but that certainly may not be true for a tetrahedral cell. We impinge on edges and corners. Also, this allows us to produce high-quality cells and accurately represent geometry, even when there are small details, high-fidelity geometric features that we are interested in resolving. So here is this same example case that we have seen a couple times now through the presentation and will serve as a bit of a thread of continuity as we go on today. And we see that we have a primary gas path, we're meshing a solid, we have the cooling path here with turbulators, and each of these geometric features we're able to accurately retain and have low skewness, nearly equal volume cells, or cells with smooth growth rate, as we go through our domain. This would be very hard to do with other cell topologies. Polyhedrals offer us that unique capability. So let's talk about some best practices, if you will, some tips. I'll give you some tips along the way as we go in order to be able to have the highest quality solution for your heat transfer and thermal analysis for turbomachinery simulation. The first is capture the geometry. There are a number of places where users may not be doing this. One is that the CAD that you're presented with or the splines that you're presented with that you're going to make blades from may not actually represent the proper geometry. This could be due to the CAD being for the machined part, whereas you're analyzing a configuration where there has been thermal deformation or blade loading. And so the geometry that you're actually analyzing may not be proper for the configuration. The accuracy of the solution obviously depends on accurately capturing that geometry. Also, and this one sounds obvious, but I've seen it more than once, is to ensure that the dimensional size of the geometry is correct. There are a number of formats that natively support units, and so then in those cases it's really not up to you to worry about. You know that the units that you're bringing in are what they're intended because it's all part of the CAD file that has been imported. But other formats simply don't support that. And so it's up to the user to make sure that the units or the dimensional size of the geometry that you intend to be modeling is actually correct. Also, we need to make sure on a mesh side that we're capturing the geometry accurately. So even if we brought in the proper CAD, we are analyzing the proper geometry, now it's up to us to make sure that we're meshing this geometry properly in order to capture those details. One good example are small features such as the leading edge of some compressor here. We need to make sure that we have sufficient mesh in order to accurately resolve the curvature here. Okay, so the next step along the meshing process to talk about are the interfaces. If we're going to be modeling fluids and solids here, what we know is that having a conformal fluid-solid interface is critical for the conjugate heat transfer simulation. By having a conformal interface, we know that we're going to have a direct connectivity between the fluid and the solid. And knowing this, we developed our meshing strategy such that this is all done behind the scenes. the user really doesn't even need to worry about the conformal nature of the mesh. How the user goes about this is simply sets up that meshing pipeline like we talked about earlier, and the fluid and the solid are actually going to be part of the same meshing pipeline. By doing that, the solver knows that we need to have conformal one-to-one interfaces between the solid and the fluid. So this is all done behind the scenes. Another important factor is prism layer generation. We need to be able to accurately capture the fluid side simulation, accurately predict our fluid solution in order to be able to accurately predict heat transfer or characterize our flow. This was something when we look at the market, we saw that this can be rather challenging, especially for complex geometries. And so again, our focus was to make things as automated as possible. We have what we call our prism layer generator, which produces these thin anisotropic cells on all of the walls automatically. Essentially, it's up to the user to tell the mesher that this is indeed a wall on which there should be a boundary layer, and the mesher will then generate these prism layers. Obviously, you have control over the thickness, the stretching ratio, the number, things of that nature, but the fact that it's able to lay down those prism layers on all wall surfaces is rather unique. Some tips and guidelines when it comes to boundary layer meshing. We obviously use these to accurately capture the turbulent boundary layer. And there are four main factors to consider. The first cell thickness, which is going to dictate your Y plus. The overall boundary layer thickness. The number of cells in the boundary layer. And then also the volumetric growth. We'll talk about each of the four of these very quickly. First, if we're looking at the first cell thickness, this is what dictates that Y plus, obviously. And for some cases, we can rely more heavily on wall functions. But if we're looking at predicting performance, for example, of off-design cases, we're really going to require a Y plus value near one. And this is just on the blades, typically. This can be larger in other places, but if we really would like to integrate down to the wall for off-design cases where we're looking at performance. The overall boundary layer thickness should be equivalent to the action. The prism layer thickness should be equivalent to the boundary layer thickness. So here we can see our turbulent boundary layer. And we see our prism layers here, these rectangular type shape cells. And we see that we have these cells stacked up within that boundary layer in order to capture our profile. So that's our second consideration. The third is simply we need to include enough prism layers in that boundary layer in order to characterize that profile. Eight cells is often sufficient for turbomachinery cases. If we were looking at drag prediction on some slender body, we would probably like to go higher than this, but for the cases that we're talking about today, eight cells is usually good for these cases. And then finally, the volumetric growth. We'll see here we transition, obviously, from our thin prism layer cells to our core polyhedral cells. And we would like that growth rate to be smooth. It's going to be smooth in the prism layer. It's going to be smooth in the polyhedral core mesh. And so obviously we want it to be smooth within that transition as well. This mesh here needs improvement. That's a pretty big growth rate between those two cells. But we can easily either modify the prism layer thickness, the stretching, or even the core mesh in order to bring those two in line with each other. One final note on prism layers is that it's not strictly for the fluid side either. Obviously, we're not going to have a turbulent boundary layer on the solid side, but there can be a strong thermal gradient. And if there is, it can be useful to use a single prism layer that is obviously much thicker than what we would use on the fluid side in order to capture that strong thermal gradient. Another feature that has come online relatively recently in the last year or two or so is the embedded thin mesher. We saw that users had a difficult time generating high quality grids for very thin geometries without having very large meshes. And that's exactly what our embedded thin mesher is for. So take the same example that has been the thread through the presentation today, where we have our cooled blade, and we have a thin component of that, thin portion of that cooled blade. And instead of putting polys into that core, we can essentially have a thin sliced mesh through that solid that then can transition to polys where the geometry is no longer thin. You'll notice that this is still fully conformal between both sides, the cooling passage and the primary gas path. Another tip is that you can use this for solids, but you can also use it for fluids as well, that you can have obviously very thin tip gaps for our blade tips on the fluid side, and you can use the embedded thin mesher in order to have a very high quality tip gap mesh in that region. So we talked about some of the key features and challenges that these key features overcome with polyhedral cells, conformal interfaces, prism layer generation, and the embedded thin mesher, which really offer the benefits of a high level of geometry capturing, high quality grids, boundary layer capture, and overall a accurate fluid side simulation and solid side simulation, accurate heat transfer results. We'll talk at a high level about the physics modeling here, where we'll discuss the coupled flow solver, grid sequencing initialization, turbulence modeling options available, as well as some unsteady analysis options that are available. We have two solvers available to us, the coupled solver and the segregated solver. For simulations such as this, I often direct users or point them towards the coupled flow solver. This solves the conservation of mass, momentum, and energy equation simultaneously and uses a time marching or pseudo-time marching approach, depending on if we're time accurate or steady state. And the preconditioning allows rapid convergence independent of Mach number. The segregated solver can also be useful, often used for low Mach simulations, and it solves the flow and energy equations in an uncoupled fashion with the linkage between momentum and continuity achieved with a predictor-corrector approach. With the coupled solver, we have grid sequencing initialization, which solves the Euler equations on beginning on a very coarse grid and then refining down to the actual production level grid as we go. And obviously, this doesn't give us the final solution, but it does give a very good guess for the initial condition. On the left, we see the initial condition achieved through grid sequencing initialization for this particular configuration. And that was done in only 80 seconds. The converged solution on the right differs somewhat, but you can see just how good an initial condition that is. And by having grid sequencing, this reduces runtime, it reduces the need for ramping of boundary conditions or operating parameters, and it also increases the simulation robustness. For turbulence modeling, obviously there's RAND's approach, LES, and DES. I imagine that LES and DES is going to be a bit beyond the compute power for some of these high fidelity, large simulations. We're going to talk mostly about RANs today. We have a number of wall treatments. We can integrate down to the wall, or we can use strictly wall functions. That would be our high Y plus treatment. Or there's the all Y plus treatment, which essentially can smoothly transition from one to the other. We have obviously SA, the Spellart-Almarez turbulence model for attached flows, where it's just obviously a one equation model, which is going to be quick. Otherwise, there are seven variants of the K-epsilon model with linear, quadratic, and cubic constitutive relations, the realizable option, as well as a few variants of the K-omega turbulence model, including SST. And the K-omega models that we have also offer curvature correction and transition modeling. When determining how to solve time, how to model time, we have a number of options available. Steady simulation, which is going to be the most common, implicit unsteady, or we'll talk about harmonic balance a little bit today as well. We'll go quickly through steady and unsteady. This is common. I'm sure you're fully aware of the capabilities here, I would imagine. We solve for a particular instant in time with one of the methods. We have the frozen rotor equivalent, essentially, where we have in-place interfaces, as we call them, where we have a rotating portion and a stationary portion of our geometry, but they communicate directly. So this is like solving for a snapshot in time. We mesh the entire machine, and this is common for cases where there's going to be a large difference from one blade to the next. So here, this actually happens to be a blood pump. So there's only three blades here, and you can see that there's a very large difference between the solution from one blade to the next. With our steady simulation, we of course can do the mixing plane as well, but here there's a couple of important factors to keep in mind when you're setting up your simulation and deciding how to treat your simulation. One is that there are actually two different types of non-reflecting treatment out there, or excuse me, two types of interface treatment out there. One is non-reflecting and one is reflecting. And what does that mean? It means that if a pressure wave impinges on a boundary, and if we're just setting mean values, then those disturbances can essentially bounce off. They can reflect off of that interface. This is where it can be very important to use this non-reflecting treatment that we have. It performs an eigenmode analysis on the interface, and the mean value in any given circumferential bin is going to be set to be the same on the upstream side and the downstream side. But the particular value along that circumferential bin is allowed to float, so that those disturbances do not reflect off the interface. This can be hard to think about sometimes, so let's talk about this. For particular blade counts, essentially, for a particular operating point with a particular number of blades and vanes, we can have a cut-on disturbance, meaning that a pressure wave is going to form and propagate unattenuated. So even if we were to extend our domain out a long ways, we would still see this pressure wave. And on the left here, if we simply set our value of pressure, so this represents either an inlet or an interface to an upstream row or something like that, if we just set our value, we can see that this pressure wave bounces off, interacts with our flow solution, and distorts our field variables. Whereas if we have a non-reflecting treatment, like on the right, that pressure wave forms, propagates, and just leaves the domain. And this obviously is what's more physical. The second option is unsteady simulation. We can mesh an equal sector in each of the blade rows. So here's a three-row machine. This happens to be the 1.5-stage Aachen turbine here. And so we've meshed up an equal pitch sector for each of the rows and run this case out until it periodically converges. This is very good for a number of reasons. We get the blade row interaction effects with wake impingement, with thermal stacking. We get all of the variations from one blade passage to the next. The downside is that it's computationally expensive. That's where harmonic balance plays a role. We recast the governing equations into the frequency domain so that we can mesh a single blade passage, yet obtain the solution on all blade passages. And that can be hard to think about, and it's a little beyond the scope of today's talk to get too deeply into the math, but we can certainly discuss that later if you'd like. But it's really a unique methodology of solving in the frequency domain that allows us to mesh one passage, yet obtain the solution on all passages. What that means is that we capture inter-row interaction, we capture all the wake impingement, the thermal stacking, we capture all of the variations from one blade passage to the next. The harmonic balance solver is a fluid side only solver, meaning that directly in harmonic balance, you're not able to perform conjugate heat transfer simulation, but this can be achieved with a co-simulation for harmonic balance on the fluid side and, for example, steady simulation on the solid side. Just to get a physical idea of what I'm talking about here with being able to capture the varying solution on all the blades as well as the wake impingement, we're looking at the modified diffusivity, or essentially turbulence here, produced off of each of these blades, and we see it pass through each of these interfaces and interact downstream. And this can be very important when we're talking about thermal profiles in our machines. There's a couple points I want to make here real quickly, is that the crispness of our interface depends on how many modes we keep in our solution. So this is up to us. We get to choose how many modes we retain in our solution, and that determines a number of factors, one of which is how crisp is that interface. So if we have a very wide wake here that's somewhat thickened by the time we reach the interface, we don't need very many modes in order to capture that. But here we see that it thins out a little bit, and if we want to be able to capture this impulse directly, we would need to have a sufficient number of modes in order to do that. But that's all within our control. That's essentially just a parameter that you enter in the solver. I mentioned that this can be very important when we're talking about thermal profiles in our machine, and this slide here illustrates why that is. So we know that there are going to be large temperature variations in our wake, and if we use a mixing plane treatment, that all is lost. We would just have essentially strips of temperature here where it's assumed to be the same value in any circumferential bin. But with harmonic balance, we aren't constrained to that. We see that we obtain that unsteady profile, we obtain these hot spots as they pass, and we're able to pass that information downstream. Just to wrap up here on the physics side, some of the key capabilities are the coupled flow solver, grid sequencing, turbulence modeling, and the number of options you have available to you for unsteady analysis, which essentially culminates in accurate flow simulation, accurate heat transfer simulation, with rapid convergence. And just as a very simple example here, we have an airfoil, a streamlined body, producing heat. We'll see that this is producing heat. And we see just how quickly we're able to converge to our solution here. less than 100 iterations in, we're able to converge to our solution. And the second point to make here is that, yes, that easily we can monitor the solution as we go as well. Very quickly, before we move on to Michael's demonstration for us, I want to talk about one validation case. This is I use this one because this is the most common validation case that I see used in industry. It is the NASA C3X vane. There have been a number of others in public literature who have used this. That's kind of why I've chosen it to perform my analysis on as well. And we are looking at two mesh topologies here, structured and unstructured, just to somewhat show the benefits of the polyhedral cell. We're looking at about a million cells with a Y plus less than one. We can see that very high quality prism layer mesh here. We can see we're using one prism layer on the solid side as well, like we discussed. We get the smooth stretching, nice growth rate. The structured grid has as much of the same attributes as possible, but obviously it's constrained to being structured here. And in the original literature for this particular test configuration, as usual, not quite all of the test data is available. So here the heat transfer coefficient was unpublished, and the turbulent inlet viscosity ratio is unpublished, and that has a big impact on the heat transfer coefficient. So the first step was to determine the proper turbulent viscosity ratio, and we see here that the solutions produced with STAR-CCM Plus on the right correlate much more closely than any of the lines here in the original literature, which are essentially the original cases that were discussed. Just to get a qualitative view, we have an image of Mach number here with the poly mesh on the left and the structured mesh on the right. And we see that without transition, the polyhedral mesh actually predicts our heat transfer coefficient much more closely than the structured mesh. And this is because of those attributes that we discussed earlier. We're able to have smooth stretching, low skewness, high quality prism mesh. But once we enable transition, essentially the two compare fairly comparably. You may be able to argue here that the poly still is doing a bit better than the structured, but they're both fairly comparable once we enable transition modeling for this case. So we see that turbulent viscosity ratio at the inlet, very important, transitionally modeling, very important, and of course grid quality, very important. All of these factors are critical when determining our heat transfer coefficient. So a quick recap of what we've looked at here and what we've illustrated with the C3X. We're able to accurately predict surface pressure and heat transfer. Transitioning modeling is important, and the polyhedral mesh is shown to perform rather well. Also, we can essentially extrapolate that out, and by taking advantage of our polyhedral mesher, we're able then to go on and capture very complex geometries. And with that, just in time, I think, we'll pass it over to Michael. He will be looking at that same geometry that we've used throughout our presentation today and perform a demonstration within the tool STAR-CCM Plus for us.
Okay, thank you very much, Chad. So what we have here, I'm just going to kind of give you an overview of the code. Some of you, as Chad mentioned, might not have used it. Some of you might be experienced users and might pick up a little something here or there. So basically what we have here is our one row turbine that we've kind of been following along this entire presentation. And I'm going to go ahead and show you, what sort of these processes look like if you're doing them from maybe a production point of view. So I'm going to start here. Maybe I'm starting my project a couple months early, and in this case I'm just doing the flow to begin with. And then I'll kind of go through later. Maybe I pick up the project in a couple months again, and I want to add on CHT. And we'll see how just easy that process becomes with our pipeline nature of StarCCM Plus. So I already have my my part imported here just to save a little bit of time. I've got my primary gas path extracted. We can go through a little more advanced stuff in 3DCAD in a little bit. However, now I'd like to take my primary gas path part and go ahead and assign it to a region. A region in StarCCM Plus is basically where the volume mesh lives. It's where we're going to start assigning our different boundary conditions. But before I start assigning my boundary conditions, I need to tell the code what to do in terms of physics. So I'll make what we call a physics continuum, and that'll bring up this panel right here. Or basically, we just kind of pick the models we want on the left, and they move over to the right as we sort of set up our simulation. So you kind of step through it here. We'll pick a 3D simulation, of course. We're going to be doing steady state and time. Our material will be a gas. As Chad mentioned, in turbo machinery cases where we get pretty high velocities, density is important. We're going to choose the coupled flow solver. We're going to go ahead and choose the ideal gas law for computing our density changes. We'll go ahead and assume this is turbulent. We're just going to pick the K omega model for now. So with that, my sort of physics selection is pretty much completed in terms of what I would like to do. So I'm going to step down back to my region where I'm going to start assigning some of my boundary conditions. So I'll pick my inlet as stagnation, and I'll go ahead and assign a couple pressures here. My total pressure, 40,000 pascals or so, and for my total temperature, I'll just go ahead and punch in 1,000 K. And for my pressure outlet, I'm going to go ahead and just change it to pressure outlet and accept sort of the default values here. And then finally, I'm going to go ahead and make my periodic interface. Since I'm only doing one blade passage, I'll go ahead and create an interface for those. Okay. So now basically my simulation is set up. I've set up some of my boundary conditions. It's very important that I set my boundary conditions first, mainly for this next step where I begin the actual mesh setup. And this way, when my mesh is completed or my mesher runs through, it takes a look at my region, determines which boundary conditions get prism layers, which ones don't. And that way I don't have to set any of those settings manually. It just does it for me. So along the same lines of my physics continuum, I have my mesh model selection menu here. And basically, I'll just go ahead and pick the same sort of things I went through last time. So I have my surface remesher that will give me a nice high-quality sort of Delaunay triangulation on the surface of my CAD. I'll go ahead and pick our polyhedral mesher and, of course, enable the prism layer mesher to get those near-wall gradients. Okay, so again, as Chad was mentioning, in just a couple settings here, I can punch in and determine what I really want in terms of mesh. My base size sort of overall controls the size of the mesh. It's sort of a characteristic length of the mesh. You have an allusion to a characteristic length of a flow. We can also do the same thing with a mesh and get a general sized mesh that we really like. I'm going to go ahead and bump up the number of prism layers just for this case. And I think I'll leave the rest of the settings their defaults for now, and that should give me a pretty good grid. Now, in order to save a little bit of time, I've already pre-generated this grid, so I'm going to hop over to another simulation, and we can take a look at it together. So here, again, I'm just doing the flow for now. So we can take a look at my grid. If I zoom way in here, of course, you can see I have those nice three prisms wrapped around very nicely, pretty high quality. If I zoom out, and you can take a look at the transition between the polys from the leading edge where they kind of coarsen out. Those look very good. They have very nice growth rates. So I'm pretty happy with this mesh. Now what I want to do is go ahead, set up my solver a little bit. By default, my coupled solver has a CFL 20. That's good enough for me, but I definitely do want to enable the expert initialization. In this case, it's called grid sequencing. Again, that's going to run an Euler calculation on a number of different coarse grids and continually refine them up until I get to my final grid, and then I use that simple solution as an initialization for my final Navier-Stokes solution. Okay, so in this case, I'm already ready to run, but I've already run this case, so I just want to kind of take a step through quickly some of the results here. So here I'm showing what we call line integral convolution. So basically, you can see on the color plot is sort of a velocity. And then in that velocity are sort of these little fuzzy tufts. They kind of look like it's kind of like a fuzzy scalar plot, so you can sort of see what's going on. Especially if I zoom in here on the trailing edge, you can see my adverse pressure gradients causing my boundary layers separate a little bit, and I have some rotating flow here. So the polyhedral cells are really going to help me out in getting that calculation correct. Okay, so now let's say, you know, I've done this calculation, I come back to it a couple months later, and, you know, perhaps this blade was having a problem, I need to fix it, I didn't do the CHT calculation last time, let's go ahead and take care of it now. So I'm still in my same simulation, I'm just going to head back up to my 3DCAD model, where before I extracted my primary gas path. So this is, you know, the same sort of model you've seen before. In one of Chad's slides there. And you can see sort of the outline of that cooling passage that's in there, but I don't have the solid part for it. You know, the CAD guy didn't get me for it. So what I really want to do is go ahead and extract that pretty easily. And just by selecting these two surfaces, I can simply right-click and tell the code to extract the internal volume between those two surfaces. And it'll go through and determine what that solid body is, and what I need to get just that internal volume. And again, this is all done in CAD. You can see in yellow I've sort of previewed my body. This is analytic CAD, so we're not doing any sort of triangulated surfaces or anything here. And what we'll get with what we'll get out is a nice CAD body. So if I hide my two other bodies here, we can take a look at that individual path. It looks pretty good. So I'll go ahead and rename some of my surfaces here. This would be my inlet. This right here is going to be my outlet. And instead of my sort of generic body 5 name, I'll go ahead and name this air-cooling. OK, excellent. So I've extracted my internal gas path. If I took a look at my bodies, I have a new air-cooling part. And I'm going to go ahead and bring that into parts. Sort of the separation between parts and regions kind of makes StarCision Plus unique. In my parts folder, I can have CAD parts, as I all have here, but I can also add in, you know, some triangulated surfaces, STL meshes and whatnot I have from other codes or something like that if I need to. Okay, so I have the solid body that makes up my blade, and I have the solid body that makes up my cooling passage. I'm going to go ahead and add both of those to regions now. And I'll begin to, you know, sort of add on to my present simulation in order to, you know, to extend it a little bit. So again, just as I did before, I'm going to go ahead and make a new continuum. In this case, I already have the gas continuum done, but I need to tell the code what to do with the solid. So I'm going to pick 3D, steady, solid, and in this case, we're going to turn on the coupled solid energy model to compute temperature inside the solid, and we're just going to go ahead and choose constant density. And by default, I believe this solid is going to be aluminum, just for, you know, just for demonstration purposes. So I'll call that physics solid, and I'll go ahead and take my blade part, and I'll go ahead and make that solid. You can see some of my interfaces have changed automatically. The code's detected that it needs to change some of the interfaces in between the gas and the solid. In addition, I'm going to go ahead and manipulate some of my cooling boundary conditions. So in terms of my cooling passage inside of the blade, I can go ahead and make my inlet a velocity inlet. And I'll punch in a little velocity on that, say 20 meters per second. And I'll drop the temperature on it a little bit, 285K. And the outlet, again, I'm just going to select a pressure outlet and accept the default values there. Now, as far as I'm concerned, right now I'm ready to mesh again. And I don't need to change any mesh settings. I've gone and regenerated my mesh already on a final solution here. And I haven't changed any of my mesh settings. All I would have to do is click this button up here that says Generate Volume Mesh, and it would have given me this, which is really quite nice. Again, I have fully conformal interfaces, even across the solid interface and into the cooling portion. And I haven't needed to change any settings just because of that pipeline process. It's very, very important. So as far as this goes, I don't even need to change any physics settings. I've already set up my cooling passage in terms of boundary conditions. So all I have to do is, you know, hit the rerun button. So you either that or submit it to a cluster if I'm not running it on my local machine. So again, I can take a look at some different stuff. I have my same old velocity that you've seen previously. There's some swirls in there simply because of the projection we're looking at. and then I can take a look at perhaps streamlines in the primary gas path. So you can see, you know, there's quite a bit of turbulence going on in there, some rotations. Maybe I don't want those, maybe I do, depending upon my model and what I'm looking to achieve with this particular blade. In addition, you can take a look at the solid temperature inside of the blade. I can see that distribution there, where all the hot spots are, where the cold spots are. Or if I'm just really strictly interested in what's happening on the inside of my cooling flow, of course, I can take a look at that. I could zoom in here. You know, maybe I do want these little curls from the, if you remember, there's some little divots in the blade geometry there. Maybe I do want those, maybe I don't. And so I can, you know, easily post-process, take a look at what's going on here. Finally, I can take a look at, if I sort of copy my blade over again, I can take a look at the surface temperatures on all these different blades, you know, determine where any hot spots lie. Maybe my material would fail at a particular point in space here, and so I can take a look at those as well. So that sort of finishes up my demo here. Looks like we just have about a couple minutes for questions. So with that, I'll go ahead and turn it back over to Liz.
Thank you, Michael, and thank you, Chad. We have gotten a number of questions from our audience, so thank you, everyone, for submitting those. Chad, I have fed a number of those over to you if you would like to start addressing them.
Sure, Liz, thank you. I see them here. The first that I see pertains to prism layers, and it says, what's the best practice for number? That's always a little bit difficult because it depends so much on the physics. But I think a good starting point is 8. That's usually where I start. It's where I have a lot of my users start. If we have a fairly benign case where wall functions are going to be just fine, it's attached, it's not going to be a problem, you can get away with less than that. If you have a highly separated flow off design, your impingement is way off and you're trying to capture the performance there, you'll probably need more than that. And so the physics really is important in dictating the number of prism layers that you're going to be involved. But I think a good place to start is 8. Okay, so let me scroll back up and see what else we have. The second actually also pertains to turbulence modeling. Do you recommend a Y plus of 1 even with K epsilon models with wall functions? And that number one kind of addressed that our wall functions actually are really good. They do a tremendous job of predicting our turbulent boundary layer on cells that do not have a Y plus of 1. However, for rotating flows, turbulence models the wall functions don't perform as well as in some other simulation environments, and so it can be important to integrate down to the wall, especially in those off-design cases. How is DES better than RANS? This is able to accurately capture some of the much smaller flow features due to the turbulent production, but it is going to be much, much more computationally expensive. There are people in the turbomachinery industry doing this, but it's usually reserved for particular cases of interest, not production type cases. Another question is, for design points, basically for design points, do we need to have a very high quality mesh for the blades no matter what, or can we get away with a lower quality grid? And the answer is that we always want to produce a high quality grid. We may, for design points where there isn't quite as much very difficult physics to capture, we may be able to reduce the fidelity somewhat, but we still need to follow all of our best practices with capturing the geometry, with smooth growth rates, with the boundary layer capturing that we discussed. So the answer is we can somewhat relax our criteria for the number of cells we needed in the domain, but we still need to follow all of our best practices. Okay, actually, Michael, there appears to be one for you, and a guest would like you to show how you made that beautiful line integral convolution plot Would you mind showing us how we can toggle between the vector displayer and the LIC?
The StarCC++ post processor is actually quite dynamic in terms of what you can manipulate it with. And basically, if you want something more traditional, I can change my display mode to a glyph. And of course, this is something you might see out of another code. You know, I can check my vectors. I can even zoom it out a little bit and see, you know, in which direction specifically the flow is traveling at a given point in space. But it's just a very simple manipulation to take a standard vector plot. And said there's this little display mode here. By default, it says glyph, and that'll get you these vectors if you want them. I can easily switch it to line integral convolution, which is just going to render that, you know, in real time. Actually, I kind of prefer the line integral convolution, even though it won't tell you which direction the flow is flowing, and depending upon your section, it can sort of lie to you a little bit. You saw that. Right here it looks like my cooling flow is rotating in this direction, but really it's just because the vector, if I take a look at my plot with the glyphs, my vectors are pointing upward, so that vector projected down onto my plane is very shallow, and that's all the line integral convolution can tell. But it's really very, very quite fast in terms of rendering time, if you were comparing it to streamlines or something like that. And I really think it just really looks cool. So.
Okay, perfect. Thank you, Michael. Is Y plus dimensionless? Yes, Y plus is a dimensionless quantity that helps you essentially determine what that first cell thickness needs to be. But yes, it's dimensionless. For physics, what turbulence model is recommended? Well, it somewhat depends, honestly. For turbomachinery, I see a lot of people using the K omega SST model, also the realizable K epsilon. And for some turbomachinery flows, it can be important to use a nonlinear constitutive relation. But typically, most people at least start with K omega or K epsilon turbulence models. Another question we have here is, in fact, Michael, this may go to you again. What's an example of a 3D CAD format that does not support units? Off the top of my head, I'm trying to think of one that does not support units. Most do. A tessellated version, for example, many of the tessellated quantities that aren't actual analytic CAD do not support units as far as actual CAD definitions.
Yeah, as far as I know, there aren't any CAD formats that don't support units. The ones I can think of that don't support units aren't CAD formats. Obviously, they're things like STL or DBS surfaces. So,
right. So the tessellated surfaces tend to be the ones that do not support CAD. Essentially, can we do transition modeling? And the answer is yes. We do have the transition model available to us. That's embedded in the K omega turbulence model. We do have a transition predicting capability available to us. Another question, and I think we just have, this may be the last one that we have time for since we're right at the top of the hour, is radial equilibrium pressure outlet available in StarCCM+? Yes, absolutely. And just to elaborate on that a little bit, additionally, we're able to use either what we call field functions, where you're able to define functions within StarCCM+ to use as boundary conditions, initial conditions, parameters of any sort, or more often tabular data as well. So you may have tabular data from a test rig that you'd like to define as your boundary conditions, and you can easily import that into StarCCM+ and apply that as your boundary condition. And of course, if there are other questions, Liz has my information up on the screen right here. I'd love to hear from you. I'm always available, and please be in touch. And with that, Liz, I'll pass it back over to you.
All right. Thank you, Chad. And thank you, Michael, for today's demonstration. Just a few things to close out today's session. We did record the event today as we delivered it, so you will receive an email in the next week with a link to that recording, so please look for that communication. And as Chad mentioned, please feel free to get with him on any questions we did not answer today. I will also pass those along to him directly, so he may be in touch with you as well. And again, feel free to contact him directly. Few highlights. We do have some upcoming relevant workshops. We host workshops all over the world, so please, I encourage you to check our events section of our website at cd-adaptco.com. And again, we have some relevant turbo machinery simulation workshops coming up in Prague in the Czech Republic, and an aerospace and turbo machinery workshop also coming up in Milan. And please note that we host webinars every week. Again, you can find those current topics listed on our website in the event section. So on screen, we highlight a few of those. So please, again, don't miss any upcoming events that you might find relevant. And we do have a number of recorded sessions up there as well that you may find beneficial. And specific to this crowd, we will be at the IGTI Turbo Expo show in San Antonio coming up on June 7th. And Chad will be presenting a paper there on unsteady flows in turbines too. So please don't miss that. If you're at the event, stop by and say hi to Chad and some of the other CD Adaptco people while you're there. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to go ahead and close out today's session. Thank you very much for attending, and we hope to see you on future events. Thanks.